This reading is from an unpublished book entitled Ah Pook Is Here. Ah Pook is the Mayan god of death, but unlike the medieval Christian conception of death, Ah Pook was not regarded by the Mayans as purely negative and destructive, but simply as a stage of life making way for rebirth and regeneration. This book concerns an American billionaire who is obsessed by a desire for immortality. He discovers lost Mayan books containing some of the basic secrets of life and death, and uses this knowledge to set up a rather ill-advised control machine. Train whistle, train in lunar landscape of northern Mexico. Cut to Mr. Hart's private car, books spread out on a table. He is reading the books laboriously from a Spanish key. Now here's the young corn god turning into death. When I die, I become death. Death is the seed from which I grow. Now this dying to produce oneself sounds awfully hit and miss to canny young Hart. Obsessed by his desire for immortality, he does not grasp the full significance of this simple survival formula, nor the seeds of disaster it contains. Mr. Hart certainly does not think of himself as a Christian, yet all his thinking is formed by Western Christianity. He thinks in either or, that is, one God terms. He is looking for the secrets of fear and death. Must be one thing or the other, he tells himself. It's all very simple. The priests became death, and therefore they could not die. Can't leave any loose ends trailing about. At dawn, death came to the hut. The youth tried to face him and hurl a magic object. He almost succeeded, for death was old and tired. The weakness of death in this passage alarms him. Perhaps the priests, postulating all those millions of years in which they had existed, killed themselves with old age. Mr. Hart is not really an intelligent man. He does not at this point even guess the real reason for these expeditions into remote past time. The priests made calculations on their calendar dating back 400 million years. Why? Mr. Hart will find out in time. He will find out that death needs time. Death needs time like a junkie needs junk. And what does death need time for? The answer is so simple. Death needs time for what it kills to grow in, for Ah Pook's sweet sake. You stupid, vulgar, greedy, ugly American death sucker. Like this. Death walks out into the field and kills the young corn god. The young corn god becomes a death seed from which another young corn god will grow. Birth and death in all its rich variety of an old outhouse. However, there is always more death than growth, even in the simplest terms of soil exhaustion. Every time you kill a young corn god, life goes out of him. The seed grows slower. The seed loses vitality. The corn god looks like a soulless zombie. And finally, the seed does not grow. No time for death. So death has to travel. Death takes the young corn god back to a time when he hasn't been hit so often he is punch drunk. Back to his youth. Back, back, back. Clickety, clickety, clack. Back to the Garden of Eden. Sure, death will burn that down too. The Mayan priests made these expeditions into past time because they had burned down present time. Mayan scholars have wondered why they did not make more calculations into future time. They were overdrawn, checks bounced, nothing and nobody there. Now, this did not happen right away. You don't get hooked on the first shot, and even when you are hooked, you can control it for a while, maybe stay on the same dose. But picture yourself on a junkie on heroin for several thousand years. Control that habit? So he goes back to the time when his habit was manageable. And what gets out of hand, there he goes further back. Look at the Mayan pantheon and the calendar, and you will see that the Mayans, as experienced vampires and time junkies, were keenly aware of this impasse and took what precautions they could to avoid it by balancing the gods of life and death. Not as Mr. Hart's accounts are balanced on an either-or basis, but through a series of transitional shadings. In the transitional forms of death, death to some extent identifies with the man he kills and shares his death. Now this seems very subversive to Mr. Hart, who never identifies with his victim. To do so would put him in danger of becoming a victim himself. Yet at some point, death must take this risk. Death must become immortal and die in order to be reborn. Hart is not willing to take this risk. He wants to be death, but he will not know death. Death will not serve a stranger who cannot prove his title, a gringo who fears the very word and sets up a house rule that the word death may not be pronounced in his presence. Hart cannot read the Mayan books. He is reading them as one who reads Moby Dick to find out about whaling and to hell with Captain Ahab and the white whale. What is written there, long dormant, is now a virulent strain of virus, waiting to escape, to leap from the pages and infect millions of human hosts. Not with Mr. Hart's greedy, Bible Belt, 19th century capitalistic message, but with their own messages, cruel, tender, ambiguous, shameless, slimy, virginal, capricious, immeasurably old and ravenously young. Itzamna, spirit of early mists and showers. Ixtab, goddess of ropes and snares. Ixchel, the spider web that catches the dew of morning. Zui Kak, virgin fire, patroness of infants. Atsiz, the master of cold. Kaku Pocket, who works in fire. Ixtubtun, she who spits out precious stones. Hexchunchan, the dangerous one. Apuk, the destroyer. Look at these poisonous color maps where flesh trees grow from human sacrifice. Listen to these sniggering, half-heard words of tenderness and doom from lips spotted with decay. Mr. Hart, who would be death, does not know to whom he is to speak. He intends to occupy the space of Hunab-Ku in the Mayan pantheon. Hunab-Ku, the one divine. Him no statue or picture was made, for he was incorporeal and invisible. He was, in short, the operator of the control machine, and in consequence did not include himself as data. However, having reprogrammed the machine to eliminate the troublesome good gods and those of ambiguous allegiance, Mr. Hart will soon encounter an acute time shortage. Death, now freed from all control, will use up all the time. And any control machine needs time. Yes, Mr. Hart, the Mayans ran it into the ground too, but they didn't do it as quick as you will, or cut themselves off with a habit as hoggish as yours. At this point, I put some questions to control. A word about this control. Some years ago in London, I contacted two computer programmers who purported to represent something that calls itself control, allegedly from the planet Venus. Control will answer any question for $1. You give your question to the programmers who feed it into a computer some way, and out comes the answer. So these are the actual questions that I sent in with my dollars and the answers I got back from control, whoever or whatever control may or may not be. Question. If control's control is absolute, why does control need to control? Answer. Control needs time. Exactly. Control needs time in which to exercise control, just as death needs time in which to kill. If death killed everyone at birth, or control installed electrodes in their brains at birth, there would be no time left in which to kill or control. Question. Is control controlled by its need to control? Answer, yes. Question. Why does control need humans, as you call them? Your knowledge of the local dialects leaves literacy to be desired. Answer, wait. Wait, time, a landing field. The Mayans understood this very well. Mr. Hart does not. He thinks in terms of losers and winners. He will be a winner. He will take it all. Last take, Mr. Hart's deserted, ruined mansion, graffiti on the walls. Ah Pook was here. Here lived a stupid, vulgar son of a bitch who thought he could hire death as a company cop.